Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. But purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the king's dainties, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. I appreciate you clicking play. My name is Randy Cantrell. I want to talk with you for a few minutes about the purpose of our heart. As Christians and Bible students, we likely think of a few passages when we talk about purpose of heart. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, let each man do according as he hath purposed in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Every Christian is commanded to give on the first day of the week as we have prospered, and to do this with purpose of heart. That is, we are to give it due diligence, due consideration, and make up our mind what we're willing to give so that we're not pained by it. It doesn't mean that we're to give so little that it doesn't affect us. We are to make up our minds that we want to give as much as we possibly can because we're happy to do it, happy to give, happy to sacrifice, happy to serve. There's a connection between happiness, Christian happiness, and service to God. Keep that in the back of your mind as we consider the purpose of our heart. You can visit the website, randycantrell.com, and find this and more sermons. Just go to the navigation and click on In Thy Paths. Romans chapter 10, verses 8 through 11. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith, which we preach. Because if thou shalt confess with thy mouth Jesus as Lord, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be put to shame. The Jews spoke of something being impossible as being afar off. If something was easy, they referred to it as being nigh or nearby. They expected the Messiah to come to earth and stay here. That wasn't God's plan, though. Paul writes to the Romans that the word is nigh thee, that is, it's not difficult. Based on the evidence, people believe in their hearts that Christ is the Messiah, and they confess their faith with their mouth. Christians have to believe in Christ by fully recognizing him to be the Son of God. By our actions, we put all of our trust and our confidence in him. He's our prophet, our priest, our king. He's our Savior. We have to remember an important fact of Christian service. God cares how you feel and what you think. God wants your service to come from the heart, not just some outward show of obedience. God demands that you desire to serve him. God cares about the purpose of your heart. It's interesting that the Bible stories of courage and conviction and determination involve men and women who dug deep to find a way to avoid self-pity. They found ways to help other people. They were always people with purpose. As our text says about Daniel, he purposed in his heart. And that seems to be a common theme among God's most courageous soldiers. Like many others who served God acceptably, Daniel had made up his mind. He was determined. He had purposed in his heart. Daniel chapter 6, verse 3, then this Daniel was distinguished above the presidents and the satraps because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm. Maybe we're tempted to look at ancient stories of faith and assume that their obedience, it was easy, for whatever reason. Maybe we like to think that we have it tougher. Or maybe we just don't want to give these stories enough thought to consider how difficult things may have been for these people of God. There is no question that Daniel was accomplished in living for God. His ability to live righteously was not an accident. His success was built on his commitment, his determination to do what was right in God's sight. The premise of our sermon today is that our success will be built on the very same thing, the purpose of our heart. As you read the first chapter of Daniel, you become aware that Daniel wasn't devoted to the world. Godliness requires citizenship outside this world. And while God's word does set some parameters about our fellowship with each other, it also clearly tells us that we cannot live outside the world. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9 and 10, I wrote unto you in my epistle to have no company with fornicators, not at all meaning with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous or extortioners or idolaters, for then ye must needs go out of the world. We serve God every day in whatever role we have in this life. And it doesn't matter if we are a student, a businessman, a housewife, an educator, a scientist, a craftsman, or anything else. Our service to God goes hand in hand with those roles. We don't serve God only when we come to public worship. We serve God wherever we are, whatever we are doing. Matthew chapter 9, verses 10 through 13, and it came to pass as he sat at meat in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with Jesus and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, why eatest your teacher with the publicans and the sinners? But when he heard it, he said, they that are whole have no need of a physician, but they that are sick. But go ye and learn what this meaneth. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but sinners. Paul talked to the Corinthians about remaining in whatever role they had as long as it wasn't sinful. That is, whatever role they had maintained before they were converted to Christ, they would continue in that role. He pointed out how we abide in God in these roles in our life. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 20 through 24, let each man abide in that calling wherein he was called. Wast thou called being a bond servant? Care not for it. Nay, even if thou becomest free, use it rather. For he that was called in the Lord being a bond servant is the Lord's freedman. Likewise, he that was called being free is Christ's bond servant. You were bought with a price. Become not bondservants of men. Brethren, let each man, wherein he was called, therein abide with God. Christians are described as the salt of the earth and the light of the world. We can't have the saving power that God intends us to have unless we are influencing the world. Our job is to make an impact on the world without becoming like the world. That's the tough part. Jesus said in John chapter 17, verse 16, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. If we're going to follow the Lord, we cannot be of this world. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service. And be not fashioned according to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, and ye may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The text reading proves that we can remain where we are in the world and still obey God. Daniel was able to do that when he refused the king's meat. He was still in the same position that was given him by the king. He just refused to disobey God because of his post. All of us can obey God. You know, sometimes a boss may ask us to work on the Lord's Day, requiring us to miss the worship services. And when we talk to our boss and we explain that we cannot miss worship, but we will gladly come in later or make up the hours that we miss, normally even heathen bosses will allow us to do that. Many times, I wonder how many times do we surrender to the demands of the world, giving it little or no effort to stand up for God. Sometimes people accept defeat in living the Christian life, and they do it without any fight at all. Daniel didn't do that. The purpose of his heart would not allow it. Luke chapter 2, verse 52, and Jesus advanced in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. It is possible for Christians to gain respect from others without joining them in their sin. That is what happened with Daniel. Daniel chapter 1, verse 9, now God made Daniel to find kindness and compassion in the sight of the prince of the eunuchs. When we live the Christian life in the most consistent manner possible, we gain the respect from even those who don't really understand our way of life. Not everybody's going to appreciate our life. Sin loves sin, sinners love sinners. And sometimes that puts God's people in uncomfortable and unwelcome circumstances. 1 Peter 4, verse 4, wherein they think strange that ye run not with them into the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you. When we read Daniel's story, it's interesting that even his critics knew of his devotion to God Jehovah. They clearly understood how determined he was to obey God. So confident, in fact, were they in his devotion that they knew their trap would work. They were fully convinced it would work because they knew that he would disobey the commandment to bow down to an idol. The world took notice of the purpose of his heart. Daniel chapter 6, verses 3 through 5. Then this Daniel was distinguished above the presidents and the satraps because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm. Then the presidents and the satraps sought to find occasion against Daniel as touching the kingdom, but they could not find occasion nor fault, for as much as he was faithful, neither was there any error or fault found in him. Then said these men, "We shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God." Would your critics say that of you? Would they say of you, "We're never going to find anything against, we're not going to find anything against them unless we find it against them concerning their obedience to God"? It's an incredible thing when even those who conspire against you, they do it based on your predictable behavior to obey God. Daniel's critics had faith that he would just keep on praying and worshiping God. Sometimes our neighbors might not have that much confidence that we'll leave the house to attend service, much less endure some punishment to obey God. Too often the way some Christians want to deal with the circumstances of life are to turn the intensity down on their dedication. Instead of maintaining a strong devotion to godly living, we sometimes compromise with truth, soften our stance in order to keep from offending the world. That's not how Daniel created his reputation. Daniel is a model for consistency and determination. He's also a model for compassion and respect and influence. Colossians chapter 4, verse 5 and 6, walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer each one. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, beloved, I beseech you as sojourners and pilgrims to abstain from fleshly lust, which war against the soul, having your behavior seemly among the Gentiles, that wherein they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works, which they behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. The world is at war with Christians, always has been. We are dedicated to something completely different than the world, and that's why the lust of this life, it wars against our soul. Two things are clearly stated in these verses. One, we are pilgrims and sojourners. We don't belong here. This isn't our home. This isn't where we find ourselves wanting to be forever. This is just where we are for the moment. Our home is among Christians and ultimately heaven. Secondly, we are to refrain from serving fleshly lusts because they war against our soul. They put us at risk of missing heaven. They are counter to everything that we are about. They will propel us toward eternal damnation, not salvation. Just saying it doesn't make it so. We've heard that phrase before. Person, you know, may say that they would never involve themselves in some sin, but, well, that doesn't make it so. A person might claim to have great faith, but that doesn't make it so. We can look at Daniel and we can minimize the faith that he possessed. I mean, it's easy to do. It's easy to do with stories like this that took place during times when miracles might occur. Perhaps we tend to believe divine intervention played some role in their fidelity. No, it didn't. God has never interfered with the free will of men, ever. You cannot find a single occurrence where God interfered with the free choice that men and women made in their lives. Who could display the kind of determination shown by Daniel without great faith? we need to pay more attention to our faith. We need to pray for increased faith. We need to focus more on God's word because, of course, it's by God's word that our faith is increased. Daniel's ability to interpret the king's dream led to a wonderful proclamation by the king in Daniel chapter 2, verse 47. The king answered unto Daniel and said, of a truth, your God is the God of gods and the Lord of kings and a revealer of secrets, seeing thou hast been able to reveal this secret. There's no real way to determine all that was accomplished by Daniel's purpose of heart, but it's probably safe to assume that great damage would have occurred had he compromised his faith. Daniel faced numerous situations that could have led to his denial of faith. I mean, surely he could have looked at the horror of his circumstance and he could have felt sorry for himself. He could have pitied himself. Maybe he was tempted to do that. Or he could have surrendered to his critics. He could have neglected God in order to avoid any political skirmish with the king. I mean, I'm sure there were many different reactions that Daniel could have had to the cards that he had been dealt in his life. But we have to remember that Daniel had already made up his mind to do what God wanted. Too often, young and old alike, we find ourselves surrendering to a temptation because we've just neglected to make up our mind that we're not going to serve sin. A lack of Christian purpose can cost us our soul. And that's why our purpose of heart is so critically important. It's not always easy or convenient to live for God. We might be forced to give up some things that we love, some things we enjoy. We might be forced to make a stand that's unpopular with other people. We might be ridiculed. We might be criticized for doing what's right. We might be fired from a job. We might lose the devotion of a spouse. Our family may shun us. Truth and godly living have a price, and sometimes the price is high. But we have to remember, it's never too high. Daniel never displayed any trepidation to do what God wanted. Sometimes we might pause and wonder if it's worth the price to be a Christian. Well, Daniel never seemed to do that when it came to serving God. We've heard the old adage, he who hesitates is lost. Well, it's true. It's very true. It certainly is true when it comes to doing what God wants. We cannot hesitate. We cannot delay. We have to move forward with the resolve and the determination like Daniel. We have to purpose in our heart. Daniel chapter 3, verses 15 through 18. Now, if ye be ready, that at the time ye hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Aren't there times when you've hesitated to do what was right? Can you imagine facing a furnace and saying what these young men said? Is our faith that strong? Do we trust God that much? Too often we lose the battle because we lack faith that we need, the faith we need to get us through. I fear it might stem from our self-reliance. We're so accustomed to taking care of ourselves and relying on no one. And we live in a culture and a world that prides itself on your ability to determine the outcomes. We work for money. That seems to be on us. We buy cars. We buy homes. We buy clothes. We buy food. We buy entertainment. It's our money. We earned it. And so much of life seems to be on us that we forget God. It's kind of like the athlete who begins to believe all the press that tells them how great they are after they've signed some massive contract, and how wonderful they are, and soon it's clear they believe it. Well, sometimes we believe it too. And we walk away or we drift away from God because, well, we're doing pretty well without God. Daniel's faith drove him to understand who was in control. Maybe faith and dedication must first develop in a heart that understands what's lacking. Maybe we should all spend more time looking closely at ourselves and concluding that if it were not for God, we would be in miserable shape. There is little doubt that a smooth life leads to a soft life where we are able more easily to neglect God. I mean, look at ancient history. It seems to always be the case. We're often motivated to go along in order to get along. It's a powerful temptation for everybody. We devote ourselves so fully to having things the way we want them to be that we may rarely consider the question, what does God want? Is this what God wants? Daniel, like so many others, especially so many that were courageous people of God, he had one question on his mind, and that was, what does God want? Dedication to God drives us to ask the same question. Our concern is to do what's right, nothing else. And what's right according to God, not what we think or what our peers may think. There is simplicity in a life that comes from that kind of dedication. Doesn't mean the actions are easy. Daniel wasn't some superhuman. He still had to do what God wanted, even though he may have already decided that he was going to do whatever God wanted. Making up his mind to serve God just reduced or eliminated any other possibilities. So Daniel had a purpose in heart that I'm going to serve God no matter what. Deciding to obey God is the beginning of obedience, but we still have to act on our faith. Daniel was able to do both, and well, so can we. He had a lot to consider, but none of it got in his way. Sometimes you've got a lot to consider. I've got a lot to consider. At times we probably consider too much. And sometimes we think about the wrong thing. Daniel was a leader held in high regard by the king. All the more reason to have a desire to please the king. He didn't have some death wish. I'm sure Daniel was just like you and me. He wanted to avoid pain and he wanted to preserve his life, but he didn't put himself before service to God. We'll obey as long as the cost isn't too high. I mean, does that statement fit your life? If it requires the loss of a job, losing love, losing anything else that you prize, do you think, well, that's just too high? But we can serve God if the cost is lower. Well, in those moments, we just need to remember Daniel. God doesn't permit us to bid on the gospel like an auction where people hold up some sign, you know, that designates how much they'll give. No, it's an all or nothing kind of a proposition. We have got to stake everything, our entire life, on obedience. Matthew chapter 10, verse 37, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Matthew chapter 19, verse 29, and everyone that hath left houses or brethren or sisters or father or mother or children or lands for my name's sake shall receive 100-fold and shall inherit eternal life. The apostles, like Daniel, could have avoided so much hardship in this life if only they would have compromised. When told not to preach, they could have just left town, avoided the conflict altogether. No, they continued to preach. They continued to suffer imprisonment, sometimes death. How did they do that? They did it the same way that Daniel and other great characters of faith did. They had a purpose of heart that couldn't be shaken. They had the truth, and they refused to give it up. They were dedicated. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 23, buy the truth and sell it not, yea, wisdom and instruction and understanding. We all get tempted to soften things up and to grow more tolerant because, well, it's the nature of the world. It's just how things go. And that's why the world has embraced so many things that 30 years ago would have been viewed even by ordinary society as very immoral. It's why our society easily, readily condones abortion. It's why the idea of teaching our kids to abstain from sexual activity before marriage is considered ridiculous by the world. It's why the dress code gets more liberal as time goes on. It's why we can tolerate sinful conduct that would have never been allowed just some years ago, because things change. Dedication to old truths erodes over time. We look for things that are convenient, things that are easy, things that are palatable. What once was the purpose of our heart, it can erode because we let the purpose of our heart change. God's word doesn't change. God's standards are not moving. What God condemned years ago, he still condemns. The changes in our society, the changes in our culture don't dictate our behavior. God does. I can imagine how Daniel might have negotiated an easier way. I mean, he may have attempted any number of compromises with the king, but that's not what he did. No, he just entered his house and he prayed the way that he always had. He just did what he knew was right, and he let God take care of everything else. And that's the summary. Obey God and let God take care of everything else. That means a surrender of our control. It just always comes back to that. By now, if you've listened to any number of these sermons, you've heard it time and time and time again, because it is so foundational to obeying God, to sacrifice yourself, to be willing to submit to the authority of God. And a refusal to submit to God's authority is a refusal to obey God, and it is a refusal to go to heaven. It means a reduction in our own pride. That means we let God take charge. It means that we purpose in our heart what we will do, and we do that ahead of time. We predetermine that we're going to be faithful to God no matter what happens. Through tough times, through easy times, we're going to obey. Times and circumstances and situations don't affect what we're going to do because we've made up our mind that we're going to obey God. God can see us through whatever dark days lie ahead or whatever dark days we have already found ourselves in. He saw Daniel through. He saw the three Hebrew boys through that furnace. He saw Noah through the flood. He saw Abraham through the offering of Isaac. He saw the apostles through imprisonment and torture and shipwreck and death. He saw his son. He saw his son through the death of the cross. So the objective in this little sermon was very simple: to help us purpose in our heart that God will be the priority of our life, and that if we will obey him, then we can also just let him take care of everything else.